Good morning and welcome to the 11th meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent. We've received apologies today from Willie Coffey and Gordon MacDonald, and Colin Beattie is attending today as an SNP substitute member. And I welcome Colin to the meeting and invite him to declare any relevant interests.
Thank you, Convener. I would simply direct you to my declarations of interest, where I indicate that I'm a registered landlord for one property.
Thanks very much. The next item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. The third item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the building safety and maintenance and housing to 2040 from the Minister for Housing, and the Minister is joined by Joe Brown, who's the Deputy Director of More Homes, and Laura Dugan, who is the Unit Head of Housing Strategy and Delivery, Better Homes Division at the Scottish Government. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting, and I'd like to begin by inviting the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Good morning, Convener, and it's always good to be back in the room and back with the committee. So thank you for inviting me to participate in this important discussion. Today, if I may, Convener, I thought it might be quite helpful to provide a short update and progress with some issues the committee has been considering lately. I'm delighted that the Housing Scotland Bill has now been introduced as per commitment in the 23-24 programme for government. The bill delivers on a new deal for tenants and represents a package of measures that will help improve affordability through implementing a national system of rent controls alongside a range of other rented sector reforms. Together, these represent a robust package of additional rights and protections for tenants that will improve their experience of renting a home. In addition to this, we are determined to tackle the negative and sometimes devastating effect on people's lives of living with damp and mould. Whilst any instance of damp and mould is a cause for concern, I am heartened to see analysis of the latest Scottish House Condition Survey data, which we have shared with the committee, which shows that there has been no significant increase in levels of condensation or mould when viewed across all 10 years. However, we have noted a small increase in homes recorded as suffering from rising or penetrating damp, which has increased from 3 to 4% between 2019 and 2022. That's why it's so important that urgent action was taken in the early part of this year. The Scottish Housing Regulator, along with other stakeholders in the housing sector, responded to this issue through the publication of new guidance for the social sector. We also published updated statutory guidance on the repairing standard covering the private rented sector. We will continue to consider what is necessary to tackle this scourge as we take forward work on cross-tenure standards. We are committed to tackling disrepair and driving a culture in which good maintenance is always given high priority. In response to your letter of 15th of March, I provided an update on the 9th of April of the engagement with Aberdeen City Council on its rehoming programme due to RAC and its homes. We are continuing the work of our cross-sector working group on RAC to understand the extent of our housing stock, engaging with those landlords who have identified the presence of RAC. We have, and going forwards, we will keep close in contact with the Scottish Housing Regulator and local authorities who have taken a difficult decision to decant residents from our homes. We will ensure that we understand the impact of the long-term remediation plans, particularly on the homeowners involved. Looking more broadly, I welcome the work undertaken by the committee to carry out a review of the housing to 2040, and I look forward to seeing the report for your findings in due course. I followed the work so far through your evidence sessions with interest, and I'm pleased to note that stakeholders and members of the Housing to 2040 Strategic Board generally appear to still disagree with the overall vision and aims set out in the strategy. However, I do appreciate and understand the concerns that are also raised concerning the challenging environment that housing sector and local authorities are facing and the impact this is having on delivery. It is important to note when we published Housing to 2040 in March 2021, we were in the depths of the COVID-19 pandemic, which was swiftly followed by the cost crisis and the fuel crisis, as well as the negative impact of Brexit on the construction supply chain, labour shortages and record high inflationary pressures. And this has been further compounded by a nearly 9% real terms fall and a UK capital funding for 23 through to 28. Of course, the Government cannot deliver the ambitions in Housing to 2040 alone, and we look forward to continuing our work with the Housing to 2040 Strategic Board and the sector more widely to tackle the short-term challenges and maintain the longer-term path to delivering the strategy's aims and visions. I hope, Convener, that the Committee finds this short update helpful. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that update. And just to say, we're going to do the first session on building safety and maintenance, and then we'll take a short break, and then we will come back and focus on the Housing to 2040 part. So I'd like to begin with a question around, I think, something that's been coming up time and time again in committee evidence sessions, roundtables, is the need for some kind of central database for information that would hold information on the design, the construction, the maintenance of Scotland's buildings. And I think you were aware of that from when you were actually here on committee. And I just wonder if that's something that the Scottish Government is considering, and perhaps starting with new builds, properties, where that information could be easily obtainable. And obviously that's come up because of things like RAC or the cladding issue, but also damp and mould, and a sense that we could respond to these issues more readily if we understood actually what buildings were made of.
I think generally, I think that's something that the government would consider. I think at the moment it's kind of looking at, in I suppose, two or three different ways. We talked about obviously the role of damp and mould, and the role of the housing regulator, if you like, within that. And the work we're doing with Alacho on that one as well. I mean, you look at damp and mould, for example, it comes down to obviously social housing, it comes down to private housing. And I think there's an element in looking at that. The RAC issue on its own, I think, is still emerging and engaging. You talked about Aberdeen, for example, and there's the work of the RAC housing, the working group in terms of that again. So I think that work is still emerging and engaging, and we continue discussions, as I said, with the likes of Aberdeen and other local authorities.
But just to come back to the question about a database, do you think that's something that we can actually start to move forward on?
I think that's something that we'd consider. I think at the moment, because we're kind of engaging around about where the damp and mould kind of work kind of sits, where the RAC kind of work kind of sits, where the cladding kind of sits, it's almost taken, you know, we move forward with the cladding bill, we're talking about RAC, that's still an emergent situation. I think as we move and progress these in more detail, I think there's something that could be worth looking at in terms of that and how we talk about that. As you said, new homes are easier to be a part of that register. We talked about the cladding, and I know we'll be talking about that next week in terms of that, but we talked about the register on that. So I think there's emerging work in all these areas. I think when we kind of progress these, it would be worth looking at the suggestion that you mentioned there and how we take that forward, because I think you're correct, data is really important when we look at this. But I think where the stage we're at the moment, because there's individual pieces of work going on, I think that's something that we could look at in a relatively short term, I think, in terms of how we take that forward.
Okay. Great, thanks. And then just kind of continuing on a kind of connected theme in a way, and I think the first time I heard about it was in a session on cladding, was the idea of a building MOT, so some kind of regular check on buildings to make sure the maintenance and safety is in place. I just wonder what the government's view is on a possible introduction of that type of work.
Again, when they keep coming back to the cladding issue, and I'm sure this will come up next week, there are still discussions ongoing with developers on that issue, wondering about the SBE process, but how do we then take that issue forward in terms of that? There'll be a number of amendments that I think have been probably put forward by Mr Griffin and Mr Briggs in terms of that, and there'll be others, I would imagine, coming forward. I think there are still discussions ongoing with developers around about that. So again, I'm sure as the cladding bill progresses and discussions go beyond the cladding bill, that this matter would be brought up and discussed. But again, that's really important, I think, in terms of speaking to the developers on that. Now, there are still ongoing discussions around about the SBE process, which we'll touch on next week, I'm sure, in more detail. But again, I think that would be something that could be considered as we get more into the depths of what the developers are saying, for example, and how we can work with them collaboratively in that one. I think that's a really important point as we work in partnership with them in terms of that.
Thanks for that. It's good to hear that it's being considered. I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Just when we're on the subject of maintenance, and particularly talking about the maintenance of existing flats, we've heard from witnesses that the current regime doesn't really work well with proactive maintenance in terms of preventing long-term issues. And I just wonder if the government have got any plans to review the legislation that governs ongoing maintenance factoring of flatted developments at all?
I think there's obviously the work around about there's the building maintenance group, and I know there was discussions. Graham Simpson had discussed this through the cross-party group on housing as well and raised this issue. I met with him on that particular point. I think there's work still going on with the Scottish Law Commission on that at the moment, talking about building maintenance and how that kind of fits in. So we're kind of waiting for them to come back, which I understand is later in this year. I think at autumn time as we've been given an update on that one. So again, it'd be interesting to see what the Scottish Law Commission say, because we commissioned them on that piece of work to look around at that specifically. But again, happy to come back to committee on that point. I'd mentioned I'd come back to the cross-party group on that point as well. And there is I think there's a separate building maintenance group that's been looking at that within that. So, but we're waiting to come hear back from the Scottish Law Commission just on exactly what their thoughts on that, because it's a complex legal area, hence why we asked them for an update on that particular point. But happy to come back or write to the committee at that stage, Mr Griffin.
Okay, look forward to seeing that update. Have there been any interim?
Not as yet. Not as yet, but hope we would get some kind of report, as I said, just post recess, summer recess. But we were indicated autumn. So if you know where that kind of sits, that could be between September, November sort of thing. But it's we were indicated it was going to be in autumn this year.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks. I'm going to bring in Stephanie Callan.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Minister. There's understandably a backlog in essential maintenance right across housing tenures. So my question, and two questions really, I suppose, how can that actually be paid for, and what role is it that you see for national and for local government in supporting that maintenance?
Yeah, I think in terms of local government, I think there's, and again, I mean, I've tried to get round as many local authorities as I possibly can. I think I've got about three to go, and I've been round all of them. The issue that kind of comes up first and foremost is, one, in terms of where do they prioritise, because we've got discussions ongoing about the retrofitting agenda, and obviously local authorities have prepared their LP strategies. What happens kind of beyond that is the deliverability, which is due towards the end of this year. So there is obviously there's a Green Heat Finance Task Force, which is looking at that broadly in terms of how that's financed. And that's looking at local authorities and RSL, so how can these be funded? You're then talking about investment in new stock, so where does that kind of fit? And then obviously the repairing standards, the repairs come in terms of that. So there's always that element that local authorities should be engaging in, you know, if they're preparing their budgets, how does that kind of fit in there? So I think the local authorities, it's very different. But at the moment, the green heat, the retrofitting agenda, and how they invest or they invest in new stock is a discussion, I think, and that would be different solutions for different local authorities. They'll obviously prioritise and what they need to prioritise in terms of that. So I think it's up to each local authority in terms of what they do around about that point. And having a 15 years experience in local authorities, I know that was a discussion that came up every year in terms of that. Now, you would hope that as a local authority, it would be looking to make sure that's updated every year. And obviously there was a backlog after COVID, which local authorities are starting to catch up on. But again, that's a decision for each local authority. So it's working with them in terms of that. In terms of, we're talking about generally, if it's damp and mould, for example, there is a role of the Scottish Housing Regulator. There's discussions with COSLA, there's discussions obviously with ALACHO as well in terms of that. So I think, again, depending on if it's local authorities, it's obviously working with them in terms of that. So we've been working quite a wee bit, for example, with ALACHO on that kind of point in terms of that, to making sure they pick it up. And there's a broader issue as well of adaptations, for example, which again kind of fits into that broader agenda. So I think each local authority probably knows more than anybody else, you know, in terms of that. So it's working with local authorities individually and making sure local teams are working with them on that as well. But I think it comes down to each local authority making their own decision on investment on green, on retrofitting, for example. And I said on local, with national government, it's kind of working with them in terms of funding, it's working with them in terms of funding for adaptations, and again, working very closely with the regulator, ALACHO, COSLA, in terms of that, and about what emerging themes come out of that.
So can I just ask then, just for clarity, it sounds very much like you're talking about local authorities having quite a joined-up approach here, as well as having support at a national level right across maintenance, repairs, adaptations, retrofitting, etc. Is that something that you're seeing then across local authorities?
I'll be honest, it's mixed. And I think one of the key things in terms of that is when you come down to local housing, because we can go through the Honda process, for example, and that's looking at the needs. And when it comes to local housing strategies, for me, it's really important around about how broad and how far-reaching that is, because that local housing strategy isn't just around about the housing itself and where it delivers houses. It's around about adaptations, it's about repairs. It's around about, and it should include enough connections as well. In my view, in terms of looking at the retrofitting agenda, where does that kind of fit in? But you're also looking at, as I said, I think one of the key things that's probably emerged for me going through the last year is when speaking to local authorities, there's always that, there's the need as well in terms of looking for housing for more elderly people. And I remember meeting, I think it was an organisation which is, it's like extra care housing. And there was figures, I think, carried out by the ONS, which showed that in the UK, there were around about 15 million bedrooms that were sitting spare into it. Now, if you take Scotland's share of population, you're talking anything between 1 million and 1.5 million bedrooms that are sitting spare in Scotland at the moment. So is there an opportunity for people who maybe elderly people who maybe stay in a big house that can kind of move in that now? No local authorities have had incentives before, or they've kind of got people kind of moving. So that's a market as well. I think it needs to be developed. So we've had discussions with care providers in terms of that, and we've got a round table coming in, for example, with Marie Todd and talking about how we can look at extra care housing and how housing kind of comes at that, what's funding around about that. Because again, you're talking between 1 million and 1.5 million approximate bedrooms in Scotland that are lying spare. So again, that you're talking about broader housing situation. But again, I think that's where the local housing strategy needs to come in and be as broad and as far-reaching as possible. So again, that's a level of the kind of discussions you have with each local authority. And again, they're slightly different because the situation in the Western Isles will be different as in Glasgow, for example. But I think that's where the local housing strategies really need to go in a little bit more depth in terms of looking at that. And again, this is where we can work with them and the discussions I have with them, but also local teams discussing the issues with them as well.
Thanks, Convener. Great, thanks very much. Now I'm going to bring in Pam Gosol.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. The committee has received concerns that the efforts to cut emissions from existing homes might lead to unintended issues like more mould and damp. What measures has the Scottish Government taken to prevent this?
In terms of emissions? Again, I think if you're looking at the new build, obviously there's new builds and standards that have obviously come in terms of where we are with new houses going forward, and I think that's an important step going forward. I think that's really important because we're now starting to see that, and again, discussions I've had with developers, they welcome that. Now, obviously, we've got to make sure that standard continues to evolve with different technologies can come forward, so I know that's been looked at. In terms of coming back to work around about damp and mould, I think it depends on, you know, where that kind of sits. Is it local authorities? Does it sit with private rented sector? And I think, again, this is where the role of the Scottish Housing Regulator kind of comes in. I know that they've written to committee directly around about some of the charters, the charter indicators that are there. So, and that's, I think, one of the key things that they're talking about in engagement in the sector, obviously, is developing an appropriate monitoring system. Because, again, I think that's really important kind of going forward, what impact is that having in terms of that. So I think that's one of the key things is in terms of that. Again, it's depending on social, they talked around about the social landlords, and again, I think this is where Alacho have got a really important role to play in that. So the regulator kind of think overviews that, and I think one of the key things after COVID, there was a note put out on damp and mould for all social housing practitioners, and I think that was in February last year, and that was housing organisations, four leading housing organisations that sent a wee bit note out on that. And I think coming back to the figures that we gave at the start, there's not been any increases, but we need to make sure that we're working around about what we do going forward. A lot of that, and you read some of the discussions around about, and I've read this before, saying it's about tenants' behaviours. It's not around about tenants' behaviours. I mean, obviously, there's an indicator. It's important that tenants look after their properties, but this is around about making sure that the property is properly looked after. And I think it comes back to the point of that Stephanie made was around about making sure that local authorities have got effective schemes in place for that. The regulator does have the ability to go in and speak to local authorities. I know they've done that for Edinburgh, for example, about how they dealt with damp and mould. So we work closely with the housing regulator. That's discussions I have with them. This is always raised in terms of that. And obviously there's the complaints procedure that can go through as well. But it's working very closely with the housing regulator, I think, is an important part. And if there is that report mechanism, if you like. As I said, the regulator did write to Edinburgh around about how they dealt with housing, with mould and damp in their properties. So again, it's working very closely with them, working with the LACHO in terms of that. And there are different, you know, and again, it comes back to the conditions of the properties now they're kind of looked after. That comes back, I think, to how do they deal with that within the local housing strategies? What's the kind of, you know, and what are they spending on in terms of that? I think data is incredibly important as well. You know, what is the actual level of damp and mould that's there that each local authority can monitor and do a piece of work on? And again, when I meet with Edinburgh, we discuss damp and mould, for example, how they're dealing with that. So it's broad, but again, I think it's very much the regulator's got a place to pay. Alacho are very keen to work with local authorities in that, in terms of that as well. But it does come back to how local authorities look after their own stock. Again, when it comes to private landlords, there have been discussions with the regulator and again with the Scottish Association of Landlords, again, giving guidance on how they deal with damp and mould in their properties.
Okay. I've just got another follow-up, Minister.
Yeah, of course.
The RIAS reports a rise in hospitalisations due to damp and mould in Scottish homes. They emphasise that currently insufficient and poorly understood guidance. What action is the Scottish Government taking to rectify a growing backlog of deferred maintenance and previously poor interventions that have at best covered up and at worst exacerbated rather than solved damp and mould issues?
I think it kind of comes back to the previous part I mentioned around about obviously the briefing note that was sent out in terms of how we deal with that. Again, I think it comes back to where the housing regulator plays its part. Now, I know after COVID there was a real focus on that because they couldn't get an inspection of properties for obvious reasons during COVID. So again, that was kind of picked up on in terms of where that backlog kind of sits. So I think, again, it comes back to working with the regulator. It comes back to working with the Alatro, for example, in terms of that. And again, the individual local authorities. Yeah, and said, you know, the housing regulator does have the power, as I said, they can write to Edinburgh, they can write to other local authorities, as they have in the past, to ask them what they're doing around about that specific point of view. We'll continue to work with the Scottish Association of Landlords, for example, and they're developing a more robust scheme of guidance in terms of looking at their tenants. So again, that's something we've discussed with them in that particular regard. So it's making sure that the guidance is out there, but it covers all tenures. It's not just social housing. It's in terms of how do we, as I said, look at housing associations, how do we look at working with private landlords, for example. But I think the guidance is there. It's making sure that we have that data and it is getting properly, as I said, in terms of the Scottish Association of Landlords, that they're speaking to their members in that particular instance to make sure they're following that.
Minister, you talk about the guidance, but I obviously mentioned that the guidance currently is insufficient and it's poorly understood guidance. So where do you see what the work is for the Scottish Government to come in there?
I think, you know, again, working with the housing organisations, I think, you know, they touch on that. We mentioned about the work that the Scottish Association of Landlords that are doing. Again, I'll raise that issue. You know, if I'm happy to take this offline with you in terms of that, in terms of with the housing regulator, and review that with them. But I think certainly the feedback we got from the sector itself, that the guidance was sufficient in terms of that. I'd be happy to take up that and come back to committee on that particular point.
Thank you.
Thanks, Pam. I just want to come back on the question around the work, the action to reduce emissions on existing homes resulting to negative consequences, and specifically a situation that is occurring certainly in my region is insulation schemes. So UK-wide insulation schemes for internal insulation where panels are being installed incorrectly, and that's leading to damp and mould situations. So what can you do? And this is for private homeowners. It's not, you know, it's people living in those houses, not even rented accommodation. What can you do to support private owners as well as the social rented sector to understand how to install insulation in such a way that we're not leading to, we're trying to, you know, tackle one issue, which is emissions, and then we're actually having these consequences, which cause huge health issues.
Yeah, I think that's a really important point. I was up on and one constituency probably a couple of weeks ago. There's a project that's insulating the wick, it was called, and they're doing a piece of work in it. It's a village maybe around about 400 houses, and there's a group being started up. And so they, 2 or 3 weeks ago, they actually had an open day. So they had Change Works there, they had Energy Advice Scotland that was there. And there must have been about 100 odd people that attended there. And one of the key things that came up was around about that particular point, was around about advice. And I think, you know, the Scottish Government obviously fund, you know, these organisations partly or in terms of that. And I think that's really important that people get the right advice. There was examples of people who came there who had just spoken to other companies who didn't meet the standards that were there. So I think there's a piece of work around about communication, which I think is really important. And that kind of fits into the broader retrofitting kind of agenda, because obviously you're talking about either the fabric first approach, and then we move then on to, you know, how's the house heated, for example. So I think there's an element of obviously working closely with Change Works, with Energy Advice Scotland, and about the work that needs to be done. When I was at that meeting a few weeks ago, there was technical questions being asked at that particular point that I didn't fully understand, but this is obviously where the trained professionals did come in there. So it's making sure that, you know, as that market continues to grow, that it's regulated properly. And I think that's something, you know, in terms of it's keeping an eye on that. How do we regulate it if we need to, in terms of that? But it's making sure there's sufficient advice that's out there. And even just that one event that I was at, you kind of seeing people asking that. But there was examples around about work being carried out that didn't meet standards and had to come back again. And you had the experts, I said, from Energy Advice Scotland, from Change of Work, saying that's not the way we would recommend it kind of going forward. So again, I think that's a real role coming back to the retrofitting agenda, is making sure that there's advice, there's enough advice out there for people, that they're getting the right advice. And it's not, they're not companies coming in who haven't got the proper training and are dealing with insulation projects that they don't actually have the knowledge for. So it's a watching brief, I think, very much on that one, as that sector continues to grow.
Okay, thanks very much for that. I mean, just in terms of that example, so that was a kind of community, in a kind of community space, that they kind of got together and catalysed that and pulled together Change yep. Works and created that event. So you kind of see very much that needs to happen in order to
very much
kind
so.
Of collective action.
I think it was an example of, you know, if they can do it in a small village, 400 or 500 houses, you know, how do we then move towards it? How do you do that in urban Glasgow? How do you do that in the Highlands where houses aren't doing? And there was another project, carbon neutral, I think we've talked about this, up in Rassie. And again, they had a conference a few months ago. And the challenges were around about in a remote community, how do they look at that as well? So again, I think there are projects out there that are working really well in terms of that, sharing the standards and so on. And that was really encouraging, really great to see in terms of what they were doing there. So there's examples, and I think that will continue to grow. How does government support that in terms of that? But how do we support local communities? I think that's a really important part, because the solution in Innerwick would be different from what was in Rassie, and it will be different as it is in urban Glasgow or urban Edinburgh, for example. So that's a piece of work I think we'll need to keep an eye on in terms of that, because people will see the opportunities around about that, but we need to make sure that we've got the advice out there to make sure that grows with the growing demand.
Great, thanks very much. So all communities on alert and get
yes,
together.
Very
okay,
much so.
I'm just going to bring in Stephanie Callaghan with a brief supplementary.
Thanks very much for allowing me back in, Convener. Just a short question. You've mentioned the importance of data and your answer to Pam Gosell there. So I'm wondering if you can say just a little bit more on that, because we have a situation where local authorities often measure slightly different things in slightly different ways. So I'm wondering if you've got any reflections on current monitoring and if the data from across local authorities is actually directly comparable.
On the data itself, I think that's a piece of work that we need to look at in a little bit more detail, and I think that's right across the housing sector, and it does kind of come back. And this is coming back to the work of the Scottish Housing Regulator in terms of what data do they collect, and how do they use their influence, I think, in terms of that. I think across Scotland, again, it's something that we've discussed with COSLA in terms of that, and the Housing 2040 group, and I know we'll kind of touch on that later on, more broadly speaking about housing, has talked about the use of data. So there's a review kind of going on. There's a review group looking at the data, and I think this is one of the issues it needs to be looked at as well. It's not, of course, it's data. If you're referring to purely housing, in terms of the repair and standards and everything else, again, I think there's a wee piece of work that needs to be done in terms of how we look at that. So that's a piece of work that I think I'd be keen to see. It's mixed across different local authorities, again, and I think that's something that we need to develop a little bit further to understand that. And it comes back to the damp and mould issue, for example. And again, this is where the Scottish Housing Regulator has got the ability to write to Edinburgh and other local authorities and saying, what's your data collection like? What are you doing around about this? So, but it is something I think it needs to be continued to be monitored on an ongoing basis all the time. So, but it's again, it's something that I think we need to progress with the Housing 2040 group, with COSLA, with Alatro, for example.
Thanks. That's very helpful.
Thanks for that. I'm going to bring in Colin Beattie now.
Thank you, Mayor. Morning, Minister. I'd like to explore one or two issues around RAC. Your letter of the 9th April was very helpful in the update it gave on the continuing work with Aberdeen City Council. However, the Scottish Housing Regulator's survey found that 13 social landlords, 9 of whom are councils, have now identified the presence of RAC in some of the homes they provide to tenants. Now, RAC was brought in, if I recall correctly, back in the 40s, originally. And equally, you know, drawing on information I have from other committees I sit on, it was never intended to last more than 30 years. And since the 1980s, there has been a stream of alerts from professionals drawing attention to the fact that RAC was coming to the end of its life. Now, of course, that predates this Parliament. So I'm not clear what happened when that initial series of warnings, shall we call it, came forward. I don't know the Scottish Office at the time. I don't know how they dealt with that. But
coming back to RAC and the councils, clearly it's quite serious. It's quite serious in my area of Midlothian, North and Musselburgh. And I'd like to know what steps you're taking to support the councils that are affected by this to remediate the risks that are arising from the historic use of these materials. Now, we're talking going back decades here, so we don't really know how long or how the scope of the problem with RAC, and it may take years to find that out. What support are you giving the councils?
I'll come back to that question in a second. I think the first point to make is obviously we're working closely with the Scottish Housing Regulator on identifying properties that are affected by that. Now that's through local authorities, but it's also through housing associations. So we're still working with the regulator in terms of that, and they're doing that engagement with the regulator and that. So that work continues. In terms of the specific issues that are kind of picked up, I mean, obviously, I think when we take a look back, that was kind of taken back. There was an incident, obviously, down south, then obviously impacted, and we started looking at it. There's a RAC oversight group, which looks at other issues. Coming back to the housing point, I think there's probably a number of local authorities that have been in touch. For example, the Clack Manager was identified as having a small number of properties. Aberdeen was in the same position in terms of that, slightly larger number of properties that are looking at. So I've met with Clacks on a number of issues, and I met with on a number of occasions, and I've also met with Aberdeen in terms of that. Both local authorities are kind of going through an options appraisal at the moment. So I think that's a really important part. Is what do they do? They've looked at some of the houses that are impacted by RAC. Now, some may be repairable, some may not. So there's that broader overview that's going on at the moment. Clacks are doing that. Aberdeen are doing that. So, you know, we've continued to engage with them. When they come back with their options appraisal, that's obviously something we'll sit down with them and discuss in more detail when they have that at that particular point. So, again, there's been discussions held on that, you know, and happy to pick up, you know, on the issue of you mentioned about Midlothian and the local authorities. Aberdeen and Clacks have been the ones that have been impacted mostly with that. So we've had a number of meetings and continue to work with them. The options appraisal part is a really important part in terms of what do they do going forward. So there's more detailed work kind of going on in both Clacks and in Aberdeen around about what's the actual, you know, what do they need to do to move that forward. The complexity around about that is some are privately owned and some are obviously owned by the local authority. So we continue to engage with both Aberdeen and Clacks and other local authorities, and the broader overview group and RAC as well is looking at that. So it's very much an ongoing discussion. There's not been any actual requirements for funding, for example, around about that. And in terms of some of the asks, we've obviously worked very closely with them in terms of some of the work they need to do, in terms of the more detailed work around about what the properties can engage. So it's kind of an ongoing situation with them, particularly about Aberdeen and Clacks, and that work. Aberdeen, for example, I think is the indicators that maybe 6 months, probably from around about March or April. So they're talking about late summer kind of thing. So we continue to engage with them on a regular basis and see what their actual specific demands that will come out of that overall work that they're doing in terms of that just now.
Certainly, as far as the Lothian Council is concerned, I'd appreciate the opportunity to happy develop to that with you.
Yep.
However, coming back to the costs of this, I mean, it's not going to be insignificant. Now, private residents are obviously going to be faced with massive costs, which they are probably, I would say, unlikely to get tremendous support from government or from local authorities. So I guess we're looking at housing authorities and council houses mainly. But going back to the late 40s, how do we identify them? How do we ensure that they have been identified and that they are safe for the tenants that are in there? And coming back to what I said originally about the original plan that the RAC would only have a 30-year lifespan, how valid is that?
You mentioned obviously before around about going back to the 1970s, for example, and I can't comment on what went on in the 1970s and what programs were set in place in there. I think the convener mentioned at the start, looking at a building MOT was an important part of that, and I think once we continue to evolve through the discussions with RAC and through cladding, I think that's something that needs a broader overview with, and then I think a broader consultation on in terms of that. In terms of looking at RAC, I mentioned about the work that the Scottish Housing Regulator is doing at the moment, so that will identify probably areas about where they think RAC has been identified. So if it's a number of houses that I mentioned before in Aberdeen, for example, there needs to be that more detailed piece of work in terms of what does it actually look like. So at the moment, Aberdeen are going through that with all the residents, and they're having one-to-one discussions around about what's the options for them, what's their own situation, what condition surveys have been carried out on the property. So that continues to evolve, and that's working with the Scottish Housing Regulator at the moment, who we're discussing that with regularly. I think it then comes back to what kind of comes out of these more detailed pieces of work, for example, with Aberdeen and Colac, and what does that kind of look like kind of going forward. I think one of the key things, and I think it was at the time when I think it was the Chancellor had indicated, in exact words, to spend what is necessary to deal with the issue of RAC. There's no funding so far that's been identified, including in the recent budget. So again, you know, we need to see what kind of comes out of the requirements that Aberdeen and, for example, in Colac that are having with that. We're not at that place yet. And obviously, these will be things that will be raised with the councils, and they'll talk about, and they've already said they would do that with us, in terms of where they get to the options appraisals and what that actually looks like in terms of that. In addition to that, I mean, there are a number of key things. One is around about the insurance. So when Aberdeen issue kind of came up, we had a discussion with the Association of British Insurers talking around about what does that kind of look like. Now, that won't cover RAC, but what it does mean is properties will still continue to be insured. The other key thing, obviously, was talking to UK Finance in terms of how do they deal with the situation around about private owners, around about what's the situation in terms of that going forward. So UK Finance, again, are involved in discussions with ourselves and with the local authorities in terms of advising residents in terms of what they need to do at this particular stage. But as I said, discussions with Aberdeen in terms of what their longer-term options appraisal, which will include private residents and social tenants as well, just what does that kind of look like? That piece of work is still ongoing with Aberdeen. We get a weekly update from Aberdeen in terms of the number of discussions they've had, what they're trying to do. We'll obviously have more detailed discussions with them when they get to the situation around about the options appraisal and what does that look like, and any specific help that would be highlighted at that particular time. We're not at that position as of yet. But again, happy to come back to committee when there's more detail kind of comes forward. But we're working closely with the regulator in terms of doing that. As you can understand, it's a big piece of work right across Scotland in terms of trying to identify that.
In fact, insurance was the next thing I was going to come to, because it is quite a serious situation. Now, I understand that insurance has in fact been kept in place,
yes,
for all these properties. However, it still is a big question mark, because insurance is not intended to cover RAC, so the replacement of that is going to be probably for the owners to be able to fund in some way. And I can't imagine, I mean, I would imagine that RAC is mainly cladding in terms of blocks of flats and so on, as opposed to individual houses. Would that be correct?
I think in terms of Aberdeen, it's more the individual houses, for example. Now, and again, because RAC's been identified, doesn't mean it can't be remediated.
Yeah.
So the condition surveys that are carried out in the properties obviously will identify that. That's part of the options appraisal, is what does that look like? Can these properties be remediated in terms of, or are there other options available? So that's the piece of work that Aberdeen are doing at the moment. Obviously, liaising with Scottish Government colleagues in terms of that, and building control, for example. But that's a piece of work that they've undertaken at the moment in terms of that. So the options appraisal, when it comes forward, will identify what they need to do to take that forward. So again, it doesn't, because RAC's been identified, doesn't mean that it can't be repaired. But obviously, the key element is what's the cost of that, and what does that kind of to do that for both the local authority and private residents.
Now, as far as private residents are concerned, is there likely to be any sort of funding available for them? I mean, the assumption is no, because a lot of these properties are ex-council houses, for example, that have been purchased. And they were built by the council originally, and a lot of owners I know are saying, well, look, we bought this in good faith, and in fact it was a substandard build, for example. Is there likely to be any funding at all in these circumstances?
I'll probably come back to the point around about what the Chancellor had said around about, you know, and spend what's necessary. As I said, there's not been anything. We continue to raise this with the UK Government. There's not been anything set aside, nor was it set aside in the budget either. It's hypothetical, I think, at this point, because we don't know what the options appraisal is going to say and what it's kind of looking at. So again, I'm happy to come back to committee in terms of that when we have more detail, for example, from the other local authorities. But it's hypothetical at this moment, not knowing what any particular ask would be, whether there is any funding that comes forward from the UK Government on that particular matter, because obviously the issue is continuing to evolve in the rest of the UK as well. So, you know, if there was additional funding from the UK Government and there was consequentials, then that would obviously change the situation. But it's hard at this moment to try and indicate that when we don't know and we haven't had any specific asks around about funding.
Thank you.
Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much. I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Good morning, Minister. Good morning to your officials as well. I wanted to ask a couple of questions. Firstly, with regards to post-implementation analysis, which the government's undertaken around some of their policies, and specifically with regards to integrated fire alarms. It's 2 years now since around about 500,000 properties in Scotland were identified as not implementing that policy. So just wondered what analysis has taken place and whether or not the Minister is aware that all local authority and housing associations now comply with that policy.
The number of things, I think the Scottish Housing Condition Survey I'm coming here showed that 1.91 million homes in Scotland, that's 75%, are fully compliant. And electrified alarms were around about 25% against about 638,000. Were recorded as not having satisfactory equipment for detecting. In the social rented sector, it was around about 6%, 38,000 were recorded as not having satisfactory equipment for detecting in terms of that. So, again, this was in 2022, I think, and that was carried out. There was physical surveys carried out between April 22 and March 2023. So I think you've probably seen more progress since then, but the latest house condition survey showed the figures that I've mentioned in terms of that. So, again, there's discussions ongoing with local authorities in terms of what they need to do to move that forward and more broadly in terms of that. But I think the figures that I've given have probably increased since then. The next house condition survey, obviously, I would be hopeful would show an increase on that.
Thank you for that. I know in terms of private owned homes, there's anecdotal evidence that this is only taking place when a sale is being implemented, not before. Is there any data on that? And the government had allocated 2 years ago £500,000 for vulnerable and disabled individuals to access support for this. Has that all been allocated, or was that money not then spent?
I can come back on that particular. I can come back on that particular point, Mr. Briggs, in terms of that. The indication, I'm not aware of the full figures on that, but I can write to the committee on that particular point. I think obviously the condition survey carries out the buildings right across, and I think there's been an increase. But on that particular point you mentioned, I can come back to the committee, unless I don't know if any of my colleagues can bring that date. But I can come back to and write to the committee on that particular point, Mr. Briggs.
That'd be helpful. Thank you. Empty homes is also something we've discussed at length. And with regards to maintenance, I know a number of councils who will not have the resources to really invest in building maintenance. So bringing forward these empty properties. Now, a lot of councils are employing housing officers specifically to look at this, and I think that's welcome. But we don't seem to be in a space where we're really pushing down on the number of empty homes. We've heard already this morning all the problems with regards to cladding and rack and what is creating even more housing need. So just wondered what the government's plan is with regards to empty homes and whether or not the government's considered establishing, for example, a national empty homes fund which councils could bid into. Here in Edinburgh there's over 3,000 sitting empty council-owned properties to really look at getting these back into use.
I'll come back, because I think there's a couple of points. One is the element of empty homes. I think the Scottish Government have spent £3.2 million approximately. We just announced another £423,000 to work with the Empty Homes Partnership. Now, that's delivered over 9,000 homes kind of coming back. The empty homes issue, I think, is slightly different from voids, and I'll come back to the voids in terms of that. I think the work around the empty homes continues to develop. It's been encouraging. And then again, I think this comes back to the point that Stephanie Callaghan mentioned in the book. You know, if we're looking at local housing strategies, that has to take in voids, it has to take in empty homes as well. And it's been encouraging to see some local authorities, with some of the funding that's coming through, taking on more empty homes officers, because I think that's really important and there's a real focus on that. The empty homes issue itself can be complicated. It can be properties that have maybe been left in probate. It can be properties that have, in terms of complicated ownership, and people live overseas. So sometimes it's not as simple as that. So I think the Empty Homes Partnership has worked really well in terms of that and delivering the number of houses, and that's why we're funding, again, by another £400,000. The voids issue, I think, is a really important issue. You mentioned, obviously, in terms of Edinburgh, there's a real focus, and we spoke to Edinburgh probably about a month ago, and this comes up on a regular basis. Again, they're talking around about how they look at voids. We've been in discussions at the moment with COSLA and ALACHA around about the focus on voids. There needs to be more work done collectively with Scottish Government, but with local authorities in terms of what they need to do. If we're talking about, for example, the number of temporary accommodation units, if you've got properties that are not sitting available because of the voids issue, then that's really important. In terms of empty homes, that could be more complex, but you can't separate the two. And it's in terms of allocation policies as well, which I think is really important. So again, discussions are ongoing about allocation policies. And I think that's a really important part of that. And again, it's different in different parts of Scotland where the voids kind of issue kind of sits. You mentioned about the number, for example, at Edinburgh Half, and we've been at various round tables where that's been discussed and the voids issue has come up. Now, I think Edinburgh is making progress. It needs to make progress more quicker, I think, in terms of that. And I think they acknowledge that and there's more of a focus on that. But that focus needs to be right across Scotland. And again, this comes back to having that broader discussions around about what's the focus on voids, what's the focus on allocations, what's the focus on empty homes. And I think that's a really important part in terms of that. And again, when I have discussions with local authorities, we go into detail talking around about that. And again, it's complex. The empty homes issue can be more complex, but it's certainly work that continues to get invested in. And as I said, there has been a level of success in terms of that. And I was just up in Orkney, I think, six weeks ago, and they talked the number of properties in there. I think it was around about 700 empty homes, for example, in Orkney. You know, and that again is more complex. So how do we work, and how does the Empty Homes Partnership work, for example, in Orkney, in trying to bring these houses forward? Some of these were in some of the islands that were less populated. So again, piece of work going on around about that. But there are more local authorities taking on empty homes officers, which I think is really encouraging in times where we all acknowledge that the funding issue, is particularly difficult. But they see the benefit of empty homes officers kind of taking that piece of work on. So hopefully that will continue.
Thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Thanks, Miles. And that's heartening to hear that more local authorities are taking on empty homes officers, and that's very interesting. Just before we conclude this this part of our time this morning, I just wanted to come back to the Scottish Housing Condition Survey. And in kind of preparation for this and in our papers, we've got information that Alacho is concerned about the housing condition survey data not being of sufficient quality to provide a true picture of the quality of Scotland's houses. And I do question it because of my experience in the region around damp and mould and the kind of seemingly low numbers that we're getting. And I just wonder, you know, obviously, because if we don't really get a strong picture of the quality of Scotland's houses, we're going to face issues down the line that are worse to deal with, and including health issues. So I just wonder what you are doing in terms of, or what you think about Alacho's view on that, and what you think the Scottish Government could be doing to make that Scottish Housing Condition Survey more robust and really give us that true picture, so that we're really serving people in Scotland and making sure that their homes are fit to live in.
I think there's a couple of things. One is obviously the data, and I think that was incredibly important. And I think we kind of talked around about the issues, and I think we talked about previously in committee is around about the issues from kind of COVID. In terms of that, I think that was something that now that local authorities are kind of playing catch up on, and will continue to do that. And I think that's an important thing. I think social landlords, for example, are required by law to meet the housing standard. In terms of that, there is the repair and standard statutory guidance that sets out what private landlords need to do in terms of that. And of course, if they aren't meeting that, then it can also go to tribunal for determination. We talked around about what the Scottish Housing Regulator are doing with local authorities. If they don't think they're doing enough on damp and mould, they can write to them and ask for an action plan in terms of that. And again, this is something we discuss with the regulator on an ongoing basis. I think discussions with Alacho and Coslow are obviously feeding into that particular point as well. So, again, it's not been specifically mentioned by Alacho to myself, but I'm happy to pick that up with Alacho in that particular point and come back to committee in terms of that. I think there are guidelines that are in place. There are actions that can be taken that are in place. I think the data and kind of collection, obviously, there is an element of catch-up from Coslow in terms of that. See, the figures that we referenced, I think, were generally standing still. I think there was, you know, they're not moving, and again, but I think there's that element in terms of working with Alacho and Coslow and as I say, the regulator, in terms of how we take that particular issue forward. But happy to come back to the point that you mentioned about Alacho. I can contact him on that specific point if they have any specific concerns. It's not something that I've been made aware of. It may be something that colleagues have maybe been aware of, but I'll speak to officials around about that particular point and come back.
I certainly appreciate that, because I'm just recalling that you and I both attended the online event about healthy homes in the Loch Arbour, Skye and Loch Alsh area. And they did their own survey, and I think they got results that were quite different potentially from, so it's that piece again about how do we get to the local, more nuanced, deeper understanding of what's really going on. So I really appreciate you looking into that further. I am now going to briefly, we've come to the end of our part around the building safety and maintenance. And I'm going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a short comfort break before we return to our questions on housing to 2040. I welcome our witnesses back to the meeting. We're now going to turn to questions on housing to 2040. And I'd like to begin by asking a kind of broad question around the vision. So we heard from our roundtable that broadly people really appreciate the vision. But I'd be interested to hear from you what you think needs to be put in place to deliver it. So concerns were raised about the lack of a delivery plan, our lack of indicators to measure the success of the strategy, and also what do you think the role is for the National Performance Framework in ensuring that we actually deliver on the strategy? Because I know at the moment housing isn't even mentioned in that framework.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Probably comes back, I think, in terms of the opening statement that I made. I mean, obviously, the strategy came out in 2021, and I think at that particular point, there's no disagreement in terms of that. Since I was made a minister a year ago, I think the board's met two or three occasions and obviously meet with board members on a regular basis to discuss their own specific issues and also the more broader issues in terms of that. I think in terms of where we had since 2021, we've talked around about, obviously, the pandemic itself. We talked about, obviously, cost crisis and obviously, the cost of living crisis. There has been an impact, and we can see that how that impacts in Scotland. I think the ONS, for example, had mentioned the loss of workers in the UK was around about 1.5 million people. Now, obviously, the construction sector would have been part of that. Now, if you're talking about Scotland, you're talking about 150,000-ish. And again, that's just an estimate, if you're talking the shared population. So that's had an impact in terms of that. So there has been an impact on that. The cost of inflation, construction inflation, I think has made a real impact in terms of that. I think when, for example, last summer I was out visiting, was told that were contracts that were literally getting changed. They were there for a day or two, and then the pricing had to change within that. And I think that's, anecdotally speaking to developers, that slowed down a little bit, but it's still at a high level. And obviously, we've had the capital budget cut in terms of that as well. So I think the key thing is that's changed. The situation's changed in terms of when it was first set. I think the objectives are still there. We obviously set the 110,000 target. There was a review planned for 2026-27, which has been brought forward to now, and there's work ongoing around about that. So the logistics of that are being worked out at the moment. We will be, and I've said this publicly, and we'll again continue to say that, there is a review going on about the deliverability of that. That will include stakeholders that are involved in the Housing 2040 strategy group. We've said that to them. So this will be a review carried out, not just by government, but by stakeholders themselves, and I think that's an incredibly important part. And I'll maybe bring Joe in a little second just to talk around about how that's actually going to work in terms of that. But I think that's really important in terms of delivery, because things have changed. They've significantly changed from there. I don't think anybody can say that they haven't in terms of that. I'll maybe bring Joe in at this particular point. There's a couple of other things that I kind of want to come back to in terms of what do we do more broadly kind of going forward. But I'll maybe bring Joe in just in terms of deliverability review, how that's kind of working, how that's going to be working, and how that's going to report back, just to give a little bit more detail in terms of how that's going to be worked on operationally, if that's okay.
I think the key point I would make is just to endorse what the Minister has said, that okay, the phase that we are currently in with the review has been internal, engaging with a range of Scottish Government colleagues with a diverse interest in housing and the delivery of it and the impact that has across government on our social and economic policies. We are about to begin an external phase of that review, where we will be engaging directly with a full range of stakeholders, gathering their views, offering them an opportunity not just to meet with us and talk to us, but to provide written material which we could then take into account in collating a report and preparing advice for ministers.
And again, convener, happy to come back and obviously discuss that when that report kind of comes out. But it's very much an inclusive approach, and I think that's a really important part. It's not just Scottish Government looking at that; it's the stakeholders as well, which I think is incredibly important But again, happy to come back to committee at any point and discuss that.
And just on the national performance framework, do you
have... My apologies. I think that's something that we're continuing to have discussions around about at the moment, what the indicators should be in terms of that. And again, happy to come back. There's ongoing discussions on that particular point at the moment.
OK, and a timescale? Autumn?
No, I think that would probably be before then. I don't want to commit. I know because there's ongoing discussions, but I think it would be before then, to be honest.
OK, great. Thanks for that. I just want to go into a little bit of detail. So we've got there's kind of key measures that the Housing 2040 strategy is intending to cover: decarbonising heat in homes, which we touched on the previous session this morning, to some degree, tackling high rents in the private sector, which obviously your colleague Patrick Harvey is working on. Another one of the strategy key measures is setting a single set of standards for housing quality and accessibility. And I just wondered where that work is at this time.
That's continued to be developed at the moment. I think there will be a consultation on that coming out relatively shortly. And again, happy, we'll obviously write to committee on that particular point. One of the things that's been raised through the Housing 2040 group itself was around about the legislation that's coming to come forward and at what pace and at what time. And that's feedback that we continue to take on that particular point. So there will be consultations coming out on the standards in terms of that as well. But we'll be writing to committee on that particular process and what that kind of looks like. But there's ongoing work around about a consultation on that matter.
OK, that's good to hear that there's going to be a consultation. I think one of the things I would like to highlight is to make sure that it's rural, the consultation. So whatever standards we end up with, we need to make sure that rural and island housing proofed, certainly, because we heard last week, I don't know if you've been across the issue around wood stoves with recent regulation that came in, and something that we absolutely need to take some action on. But I think if we're going to bring in a single set of standards for housing quality and accessibility, that we've already talked this morning, you yourself have highlighted the nuanced approach that we need to take across Scotland, because the issues are different for island communities and even mainland communities and central belt and so on and so forth. So it would be good to see that whatever the consultation is, it supports all voices being heard through that.
I think you're right. You and I were at the Rural Housing Conference a couple of months ago now. I don't remember when it was. And again, that issue was raised, and I think that's incredibly important. I think I mentioned at that conference itself that I was keen to get out, and I'd done this last summer, to get out and visit as many communities as possible. One, to talk around about how they build more housing, but two, in terms of the points that you raised there, and we talked about carbon neutral RASI, for example, and in terms of what that kind of looks like. And again, it's trying to encourage local authorities, but it's trying to encourage local communities to try and take on that as well. And it's encouraging when we talked about carbon neutral RASI and other groups that are kind of going on around about them picking up that. So how do we support them? How do we support local authorities? Mm. Because it is incredibly important in terms of having that rural aspect of your look.
Yeah.
And so I will be in a already had a number of invites to go out during the summer and visit as many local and island communities. So again, we'll be picking up that and speaking to them about their own particular issues. But yeah, you're right. It needs to be more nuanced and have that rural approach as well.
Good. I'm glad to hear you're aware of that. I just wanted to move on to placemaking. So another key strand in Housing 2040 is around placemaking, and we've kind of been flagged up to us through our roundtables concerns around the ambition of placemaking and that it's not going to be achieved, partly because of the failure of the current planning framework to take into account the concerns and needs of local residents and the focus on developing unaffordable private rented housing. But also there's, and again, you'll be aware of this, the challenges around local authorities not really having the resources and the skills to deliver on it. So I just wondered to what extent do you think the ambition is being realised and can be realised given those circumstances?
I think there's a number of things. One, obviously, there's the resource review going on at the planning at the moment. We've had, I know RTPI, for example, have been involved in that. Craig McLaren obviously is doing more work. I know Craig's been at this committee before around about that. We had a round table, Joe Fitzpatrick and I had a round table with a number of developers from Scotland and other groups probably around about 3-4 months ago now. We've got another round table planned, and one of the key issues was how do we develop the placemaking element, because I think that's incredibly important in terms of how we do we deliver communities, not just delivering housing, but how we deliver communities. And I think that's really key in terms of how we look at that. So I think the resource review is picking up on that issue in terms of how we move. And we'll remember the discussions we had here with NPF4 over a number of months and felt like years at that particular time, is how do we get NPF4 and what's the transition from NPF3 to NPF4, particularly in about local development plans. So again, when you're talking about resource review, I think that's important. When we had the round table with the head of planning there, it was talking around about how do we make sure that the transition between NPF4 to local development plans, and they're all at different times as we know local development plans, how does that kind of work? So that round table kind of touched on that, and there's another round table planned on that particular point. But placemaking is essential. It's incredibly important in terms of that. And I think, you know, the resource element is really is part of that. So there are ongoing discussions, as I said, in terms of NPF4 and how that kind of fits into planning and local development plans themselves. So, and I think we discussed that at committee, but that was always going to be the challenge, is how do we move from NPF4 into local development plans in that transition when they're all at a slightly different period of time. But the resource review, as I said, is an incredibly important part of looking at that.
Yeah, and of course also not just the local development plans, but also making sure that the local place plans that communities are busy developing now, but maybe not quite alive to it yet, and will come on board doing that to make sure that those usually very rich evidence-based, based on experience, ideas that they come forward with are honoured, and you know, that communities actually start to see those things around them.
I think that's really important, because I think in terms of the local place plan needs to fit into the local development plan. I think that's important. But local place plan, and it comes back to local development plan, we're not just talking about housing. We're talking about green space. You're talking about business. How do we make the growth of business? There's, for example, one of the key things, and a lot of work that we're doing at the moment is working with SSEN and local authorities in terms of some of the renewable hubs in Scotland. What does that need in terms of temporary accommodation? What does that need in terms of opportunities for legacy housing? What does that mean in terms of, you know, how do we support business in terms of that as well? So there's a lot of work kind of going on with SSEN, which I'll probably touch on later on, around about what does that kind of look like. So there's an influence about how do we support business development in terms of that as well. So it's business, it's placemaking, it's business, it's green space. It's also looking at the viability, and I know you and I have had chats about this, viability of high streets, for example, and that's a challenge around about town centres. So that has to be an element in that as well. So the placemaking isn't just about new housing, it's how does all that kind of fit in, and I think that's a really important part. And I think the local place plans are an exciting part, I think, of what the government's trying to do and what everybody kind of supports. It can be complex, but it needs to make sure it's community-based. It's not just developed, for example, by local authorities. It needs to make sure it's got that element of support for local communities, if they like to develop that themselves. I think that's really important. But we need to make sure that's resourced within local authorities, and this is where the resource review, I think, is really important in terms of what that looks like.
Yeah, I think that would certainly be appreciated. I mean, I had conversations with people who talk about the idea that communities need to be leading because they live in the place, and local authorities facilitate that and support it, and then developers actually come in and deliver on the community's vision, which we have we've got it going the other way around at the moment, and you end up with sprawl on the edge of towns with lack of transport networks and kind of going in the opposite direction of what we really need to be doing. Lack of place. Yes, you may have a shop in there, but where are the places for people to actually come together, for community to actually happen? And obviously also another aspect of placemaking is the active travel networks that we're keen to see delivered through the national planning framework. So anyway, good to hear that you're aware of those things and keen to support that placemaking really does come about. I'd like to bring in Miles Briggs, who's got a number of questions.
Thank you, Convener. Many housing developers and especially housing associations have highlighted the current challenges in delivering affordable housing, particularly in the context of the recent budget and cuts to affordable housing supplies. But looking at where we've been progressing in Scotland, we've seen a 5% decrease in the number of affordable housing approvals since 22, a 20% decrease in the number of affordable housing starts in that period as well. So I wanted to ask, what are the Scottish Government doing with its partners to look at this decline, and the projected numbers clearly are not going to meet the Housing to 2040 target if this is what we're going to see, and where government are responding to this, and I'll come in with some separate questions maybe beyond that.
I think it's important. I think it's important to set context. And the house builders will tell, in terms of the macroeconomic situation where interest rates have been, hasn't helped the market. It's not helped the market in Scotland or Wales or England, for example. So I think there's probably a more positive outlook in terms of that. And again, in speaking to developers, the words I've heard are green shoots. So there's that recovery kind of going on. I think the next interest rate decision will be interesting to see where that kind of goes, because I think you'll start to see the market kind of picking up. So hopefully the macroeconomic situation will make a difference. Because again, that doesn't just impact, obviously, on people's general outlook, but it obviously impacts on the cost of borrowing. So when you're speaking to SFHA, for example, or individual housing developers, that's been an element, because they've kind of budgeted in terms of interest rates at 2 or 3%, and they're paying 5% plus in terms of that. The covenants, and I'll touch on the banking side of things, are particularly tight around about borrowing as well. So I think there's that. In terms of the house building, the completions last year were at the highest rate for around about 20 years. So I think that's the context going forward. I appreciate the challenges, and we've seen the drop that are kind of coming forward in terms of that. I think there's a number of things, I think, in terms of that's really important. One is, and coming back to the Housing 2040 strategy group, we talked about the longer-term objectives, but the last group we talked on about what are the most important priorities at the moment. One was obviously was the supply, and touch about Joe or Laura coming if they want to see something on that particular point. There's a group talking, looking at the short-term supply. You're then talking about the number of voids, empties, and that's not in the house building itself, but talking about the short-term supply. The other particular point they mentioned was about innovative finance. So there's been a number of discussions that we've had in the last number of months in terms of that. It was one of the key priorities, and I think I've said this before when I came into post, was around about flexing up finance and around about the sector. So a number of months ago, we had a round table with housing associations, and again, talking with SFT, talking with SNB, talking with Hubco, for example, around about other different models we can look at. So that work continues. We had the same one with Registered Social Landlords and Housing Associations in terms of that. So is there more work we can do in that particular point? So again, that's been mentioned just 2 weeks ago. I was down in London. We set up and had the first meeting of the House Investment Task Force, which included institutional investors, which included banks, which included members of Homes for Scotland, for example, that were down there. It included Alacho, it included local authorities in terms of that. Trying to look around about how we can look at how do we look at various models of financing in terms of that. Now, that will be, and I'll ask Joe maybe to come back on that particular point as well, in terms of what does that group look like. There will be minutes published to this group. They will come forward with recommendations. So again, this is coming back to the whole collaborative approach in terms of working with the sector, in terms of how we look at it, in terms of that. Ken Gibb was also down there and talked around about the opportunities. And I don't know if you've seen there was an article in the Herald where he talked around about the UK and Scottish governments working together, for example, around about guarantees, about additional borrowing powers, around about local housing allowance. Because, and his exact words are, housing's not wholly devolved, and it's not. So there'll be some ask, and I think it's important if whatever the new government, whoever it is, the government is in October, November, there'll be a number of discussions that we'll need to have around about that. How can they give us that ability to be more flexible in terms of finance? And I think that's really, really important in terms of that. So I think that's a kind of a broad overview. There's a couple of other points that I want to mention. I don't know if Laura wants to come in about short-term supply or Joe wants to come in about that, in particular in about the Housing Investment Task Force and how that will continue to develop. You know, there'll be separate groups that will take that forward now. It meets quarterly basis, it'll come back. But I don't know, Laura, Joe, I don't know if Joe, you want to kick off and just on that particular group. And again, the logistics around about what that looks like.
I suppose the first thing, before I come to the task force, I guess, I would confirm the Minister's point about the statistics giving, as I suppose, a range of different signals about the complexity of how the market is operating in Scotland. For example, our affordable homes completions in 2022-23 actually increased by 7% over previous years, and that was the highest annual completion figure in any financial year since the start of the statistics series into 2000. But you know, that statistics, you know, it sits in contrast with a range of others, which I think it illustrates the range of challenges which the Minister has already alluded to. In terms of the Housing Investment Task Force, we've had the first meeting of that group and we'll shortly be publishing on the website, Scottish Government website, the remit of that group, having had a discussion with the group to get that confirmed and agreed. The membership of the group will also be published, and I'll make sure that the clerk gets that material separately from this conversation. The main focus of that meeting was to, I suppose, establish the main barriers to investment across all tenures, and to agree a way forward in terms of which of those would be prioritised and how we would operate, using the knowledge and experience of the members of the group and others. I mean, we proposed and it was agreed that we would operate through subgroups, which will focus on specific priorities, projects, and drill into those and come back to subsequent meetings of the group to check in and have, I suppose, substantive discussions in plenary. The next meeting of the group will be in June, and as the Minister has already mentioned, we will be, with the group's agreement, publishing notes of those meetings, and work to do that is in hand.
Thank you for that, and it'd be useful, I think, to keep committee updated on some of that. And you talk about barriers, because I think one of the things, looking back at the government's rent control policy, it was quite clear from housing associations, and they warned us, I think, the Minister, in fact, was asking a number of questions on this when he was a committee member as well, that mid-market rent development would dry up, and we have seen that for housing associations. So is there a specific commitment then to look again at that for housing associations to try to get that mid-market rent development potential going again, and these discussions the Minister's outlined, is that central to that as well?
I think obviously we were down there, because part of the discussions we've always had is with the investment sector itself. Housing associations have mentioned that particular point was mentioned, and so that these will be things that will be discussed and how we look at that in terms of going forward. I think very quickly after the housing bill it was published, I had a meeting with yourself, obviously, from opposition spokesman and Mr Griffin, in terms of that, and we'll continue to be open about that. I'd said it was a very open and transparent process I wanted with yourselves in terms of that. So I think that these are some of the things that have been identified. These are things that we'll be looking at in terms of that, and broader investment opportunities as well. I think, Kenny, looking at that as well. So again, but this is, and one of the key things I think for me is coming back to the House Investment Task Force was brought together in terms of trying to get the views from other stakeholders. We talked about the housing deliverability review, and again, just then put stakeholders, and I think I mentioned in an opening speech, I can't deliver this on my own. We need support and we need influence, and we need obviously thoughts and ideas coming forward from the sector. So it's very much trying to look at that broader approach in terms of that. The other thing that's really important as well, and I know Home for Scotland talked about this, is how do we develop the SME market in Scotland to make sure they play an important part as well. It's not just the big housing developers, how do we play that part as well. So other discussions are in about how we support SMEs. So there were Homes for Scotland members that were there that feed into the process as well in terms of that. And again, it comes back to where housing associations kind of sit. So the group will be looking into these in details in a lot more detail and coming forward with recommendations to government in terms of that. I think this is an incredibly important part that we need to look at in terms of how do we flex up the finance within the housing sector, not just in Scotland. I think that needs to happen right across the UK. There are guarantees, for example, that the UK government has that we don't have that would make a massive difference in terms of that. So again, it's looking at barriers in terms of, and opportunities around about what can be looked upon and where does other things work in terms of that. So, and again, that's part of the broader work that kind of goes on. It feeds into the housing, to the 2032 target around about deliverability. So that these pieces of work we're going on together in terms of that. And there's a few other things I want to touch on in terms of how do we look around about supply, how do we look at demand, and how do we aggregate demand and look at the opportunities around about that. For example, around about town centres, city centres, in terms of that as well. But I can touch on that as probably developed. I don't know if, Laura, you meant to say anything at all about it.
So. Thanks for that. I think, you know, most importantly is getting to outcomes, not these discussions, yep, but what will actually make a difference. Yep. And here in Edinburgh, the loss of that mid-market rent has been catastrophic, really, for our housing market. And getting that back, I think, is really important. I wanted to move on to homelessness, because the Scottish Housing Regulator have reported systemic failures in the delivery of homelessness services in some councils, with other councils at risk of failure. So I wanted to specifically ask what the Scottish Government's response has been, and with councils across Scotland declaring housing emergencies, what has been that response? We haven't seen the Scottish Government declare a housing emergency, but we're seeing councils doing that, my own here in Edinburgh being one of them.
I think there's a number of things. I touched, first of all, there's money set aside, obviously, this year, and I think there's £35 million that's been set this year in terms of that. In terms of the housing emergencies that have been declared, I was up in Argyll and Bute just last week, the week before that, talking to them, housing associations, in terms of where they were, the local authority itself, the Aroostook Transfer Authority, and also some of the island communities. So they were talking about they're developing a housing emergency action plan, and we've agreed to work very closely with them. It's the same discussions we've had with Edinburgh, for example. They have their housing emergency action plan. I've actually got a meeting with Edinburgh, I think, tomorrow or Thursday, where we'll be going into more detail around about that specific point. Glasgow are developing theirs, and again, we've agreed to work with them on developing that as well, because again, it's very much and how and Fife, again, similar discussion. They're developing our housing emergency action plan, which will come forward, I think, in June, they're indicating. So again, we're working very closely with them in terms of how we develop that, how they develop that, and how we're working specifically with them. And it comes back to the point I think I've mentioned in both the Chamber, and you know, their response is different in each different particular part. So I think it's important we work specifically with each local authority in terms of that. So I mentioned around about the funding that's been set aside already in this year, and we've been working in terms of that with them. I think it then comes back to the specific points around about the issue around about, particularly around about voids, empty homes, and again coming back to allocations. Now, there are some figures that we've had that we're clarifying at this moment, which indicates there's a lot of work to be done in terms of voids, empty homes and allocations that would make a real difference. So again, these are the discussions we've been having. So we've been discussing that with Alacho, we've been discussing that with COSLA, for example, and these discussions kind of ongoing. I'm confident there'll be something to come out of that very shortly in terms of that. And obviously, we'll come back to committee on that particular point. It comes back, and again, there's a couple of other important factors, and we talked about this. And I think the report from the Homelessness Monitor, and obviously it was a crisis, talked about another couple of kind of issues. And this is where we're talking around about working in collaboration with the UK government. One was, you know, the two biggest issues they mentioned. One was around about local housing allowance. And again, this for me will be a key ask for whatever government comes in October, November time. In terms of that, we need to be increasing local housing allowance. There is no doubt about it. And that's not my words. This is the words. This is a Homelessness Monitor. Headache One University carried that work out. And the second biggest part they mentioned was the level of universal credit. So again, that's something that needs to be taken in terms of that. Of course, we need to increase supply, and we need to be building more homes. I talked about what we're talking about in the Housing Investment Task Force and what we can do around about that and talking about the supply side. But we do need support from the UK government in terms of local housing allowance and on universal credits, because, as I said, this is not my piece of work. This is what Crisis and the Homelessness Monitor have continued to say on an ongoing basis. So that comes back to the asks of the UK government when it comes in. But of course, we need to be building more homes. I'm not going to say that. You mentioned the figures themselves. So how can we increase the finance that's available to build more homes, for example? And there's a lot of piece of work. Housing Investment Task Force and other pieces of work are going on around about that. And I suppose the other key thing, kind of coming back to the point around about that, is, and I think there's opportunities. I talked about the work of SSEN in terms of the seven renewable hubs in terms of that in Scotland that are being built. Seven or eight are being built. So SSEN have just employed somebody to go through that. So we're talking about what's the reference to homelessness is. If we're looking for accommodation workers in these areas, if we don't have enough housing, whether it's temporary accommodation or whatever, then all that's going to do is increase homelessness in these particular areas. So there's a detailed piece of work going on with SSA in terms of how do we house temporary accommodation workers over a period of 2 or 3 years. But what are the legacy opportunities in terms of that? So, for example, there was a meeting up at the Green Freeport we had in November where we had the five developers that were up there. The big five companies that are involved up there, we had, I think, around about a dozen housing developers, around about which 10 hadn't built in that area at all. And we also had economic development opportunities. So that's been replicated across Scotland. So how can we make sure that doesn't impact on different parts of Scotland? So there's that piece of work kind of going on. But it also leaves an opportunity to build more houses in terms of that as well. So that's kind of pieces of work kind of going on. In terms of the homelessness, obviously the voids, the empty homes, the allocations is something that we can work on. But we need to be building, of course, we need to be building more homes in terms of that. And we kind of touched on what that would kind of look like. So,
can I just asking, you know, to get back to homelessness services specifically, you know, we're seeing record numbers of rough sleeping again being recorded. The Scottish Housing Regulator has been clear in terms of systemic failures. So for these councils, and I'm talking about my own again here in Edinburgh, what work is the government doing with them? Because the preventative work in the housing bill we all accept, we all want to see, but, you know, that's a piece of legislation in the future. The here and now, we are seeing these problems, and we don't seem to be seeing that emergency response to say to councils what's happening. We're seeing record number of people living in temporary accommodation and children. And it doesn't feel like government and council are necessarily then connected in an emergency response to that at this current time. There's not even the recording of data in terms of people sleeping in their cars, for example, and not then declaring themselves homeless. So I just wondered where government was in that, because the next set of statistics, I think, will be worse. And so where are we as a country in trying to work with councils, which have the biggest pressures, my own in Edinburgh being the top of that list?
A couple of things. I think one I mentioned about the funding, it was this year, and that's part of the £100 million in Homeless Together funding as well. There was £2 million set aside, which we negotiated and discussed with COSLA in terms of the authorities that needed that most in place. It's not my place to say to local authorities in terms of that. Now, Edinburgh, for example, received part of that funding. I talked around just previously in terms of working with Edinburgh and how they're developing a housing emergency action plan. So officials are working with them collectively in terms of what that kind of needs. We're also asking them in terms of, you know, specifically what do they need. Now, one of the key things that Edinburgh talked about was employing another empty homes officer, and in terms of that, and again, I think that's starting to make an impact. So we're asking them specifically what do they need in terms of, not just in terms of funding, but in terms of, you know, for the empty homes officers made a difference, I think, already in terms of what they're doing in Edinburgh. So I mentioned about the work we're doing with the other local authorities are declaring a housing emergency, and we're working collaboratively with them as well. So I would disagree with you in terms of not working closely with them, because officials will tell you that's not the case. We are working very closely with them. I've got a meeting with Edinburgh, I think, either tomorrow or Thursday to talk about the specific points around about that. In terms of that, obviously we're talking about their acquisitions. We set £60 million aside last year about acquisitions. So again, that's been picked up in Edinburgh. I've taken advantage of that in terms of that. And again, we're working very closely, for example, and Edinburgh acknowledged this, around about the voids issue. They've got far too many voids and they acknowledge that. So we're working very closely with them in terms of what do we do to get the voids figures down? How do we get empty homes back into that as well? So it's very much that partnership approach that we've got with all local authorities have declared a housing emergency in terms of that. I had indicated we're in discussions with Alacho and COSLA at the moment around about a more joined up piece of work across Scotland in terms of that, and hopefully be able to come back relatively shortly on that with more details. And again, in terms of looking at that, because we need to be doing more about voids. We need to be doing more about empty homes. We need to be doing more in about the allocation policies that are kind of sitting in there. But it does come back about building more homes. And we talked around about the more homes and element, and we're talking about trying to flex up the financing around about that. There are real opportunities, I think, in terms of what we've got, in terms of flexing up the finance system that can get more money into the sector. Not to replace the grant system in terms of that, but in addition into that. And again, you're seeing the likes, for example, of Ken Gibb coming back and saying there needs to be more collaboration between the Scottish Government and UK Government. Now, Ken's part of the Housing Investment Task Force. Ken's been at the committee before and is very much respected in terms of what he has to say. He advises all four governments in terms of that. So again, it's working with the sector in terms of how we get more money into the sector to build more houses. But we are working closely with the local authorities that are talking about that, including Edinburgh.
Thank you. Just finally, in terms of those who have been staying in temporary accommodation, sometimes up to over 2 years, what work's going on to look at these individuals and families? And, you know, we've had discussions at committee around children in temporary accommodation. And for example, legally, councils are only meant to be having these families in for a week in temporary accommodation. It's years for many people here in Edinburgh. So what work is going on specifically around that? And, for example, a ban on families, pregnant women being placed in temporary accommodation with councils, and a new model, because I think kind of looking towards what's happening with significant resources, I think £27 million has been spent in Edinburgh on people being placed in temporary accommodation. So why aren't we doing different systems to get a different outcome? And what work specifically then is going on within councils and government around that? Because I, as an Edinburgh MSP, haven't seen any progress on that since I was elected. And I think we need to see maybe a different approach and not just keep repeating the same and hoping for a different outcome.
And I would agree, a couple of things. One's obviously come back to the acquisition policy, which Edinburgh have taken cognizance of and are working with that. And I think, again, in terms of how they allocate properties, that's something we've had in terms discussions with them on that. I think that's really important. There's other pieces of work going on around about, one coming back to prevention duties, for example. I mean, I went down and met One Parent Family Scotland, and there was some young women who ended up in a homeless situation. Part of that was they weren't aware of what they were entitled to in terms of benefits, you know, whether that's Scottish Child Payment, in terms of other things that were out there. So I think in discretionary housing payment, the discretionary housing payment is a really important part, and again, it comes back to asks of a new UK government in October, November time. We spend £90 million a year on discretionary housing payments. Now, I would love to be in a position we could spend £90 million a year on trying to support and getting families out of temporary accommodation. So again, that's an ask, a very clear ask of a government that comes in October, November, wherever the election is going to be, to make sure we don't have to pay that £90 million, because I think that's really important. In terms of the specific work, I mentioned the discussions going on with COSLA and Alacho. These are, you know, I think the areas you mentioned about families has been mentioned in and about that. I think there's other models that could be looked at, for example, around about supported accommodation. And I know you and I have talked about Brown Alba, for example. So what do we need to do around about supported accommodation? And I think there's an element of work that Edinburgh are looking at in terms of how do we support that. There's an element of social investment into that. And again, we've had a number of discussions with investors into that particular area. And Brown Alba were one example, for example. I know there's other homelessness charities in Edinburgh that are looking around about that. And one of the key things that came out of the discussion last week when we were down in London, there was an institutional investor who funds homelessness accommodation, and it's a lease model. And they're working with certain local authorities down in London. Now, that model has worked. The investment, the investors get their rate of return, a low rate of return, but the money that's been saved on temporary accommodation costs, as you've been mentioned, more than meets in terms of that. So again, this is one of the opportunities that would come out talking to institutional investors and about that lease model. So it's looking at that. These will be one of the issues that will be kind of taken forward in terms of that. So how can we look at different ways to kind of finance that as well? Because you're right, we spend far too much money in temporary accommodation. We need to be doing more by building more houses, but we need to look at more models in terms of how we get temporary accommodation to get these figures down. Again, working around about allocations, acquisitions. We mentioned about voids and empty homes on a short-term basis. But there are different models that we need to look at. As I said, these are kind of being discussed with COSLA and Alacho in terms of what we need to do to take that forward on a more national level, in terms of looking at other models, how we deliver temporary accommodation units, because that's part of the problem. There are models out there that we need to see where they work, how can we make them work in Scotland. That will be part of the group that the Housing Investment Task Force will continue to look at.
Okay, thank you. Thanks.
But happy to discuss any issues around about Edinburgh as we, you know, we catch up on a regular basis. So happy to discuss these further.
Thanks for that. Colin Beattie.
You know, Minister, a number of stakeholders have indicated that there should be a focus at the moment on increasing the availability of social housing, and obviously in response to the numbers of people who are homeless and in temporary accommodation. Do you think that there should be a particular focus in investing in social housing above and beyond any other priorities at this time? And secondly, how do you respond to suggestions that this should in part be driven by a national acquisition strategy? Now, I know individual councils buy particularly ex-council houses back, but it's not a massive volume. And we keep talking about avoiding housing voids. You know, for the last 20 years, I've been hearing about housing voids and how to manage them. And here we are still, you know, deja vu all over again. We don't seem to be making that significant impact. How can we change that? How can we get a different approach on that particular point?
I'll come back to the social housing one first. I think there has to be an element of building more social housing in terms of that. Now, that could be local authority housing. There's a piece of work that you know has been carried out by Ken Gibb. I mentioned Ken earlier on talking about, and we raised this in committee before, is what's affordable housing? So Ken Gibb was asked to go away and come back with what that definition is. What is affordable housing? And affordable housing can be a number of things. I think Miles talked to him about MMR. I mean, MMR plays an important part of that, because I think MMR can play an important part for people who can't afford a deposit, but it's still affordable in terms of that. So what's affordable what does affordable housing mean? I think the word, and I'm looking forward to getting that piece of work from Ken, and I think Ken would probably write to the committee, I would imagine, at some stage on that particular point, because we have raised it at committee on a number of occasions, and I remember doing that myself. So I think that's important in terms of what does affordable housing look like and how do we work around about that, because I don't think we actually got a definition of what that actually was. I think there has to be, and I've said this before, there has to be an all tenure approach. There have been lots of examples in developments I've went to where it's been all tenure, where it has had an opportunity when you're talking about houses for sale, MMR, and houses for rent. So I think there needs to be that element as well. So it has to be an all tenure approach. In terms of within how you look at the financing for local authorities in terms of what they do, you know, the discussions we've kind of gone on around about the financing of local authorities and what they need to do around about Housing Investment Task Force, for example, is a really important part. It's how do we get more money into the sector. The Housing Investment Task Force minutes will show that was discussed at that particular point. How do we get more money to local authorities? And I come back to the point, for example, around about the point that Ken Gibb mentioned around about guarantees about borrowing powers and so on. Now, that will be continued, and he's made that very clear. In terms of that, I think what was important, you actually seen, and again, it comes back to, I noticed Kezia Dugdale, for example, who represents Shetler, supported that paper. She came out and said that very clearly in terms of what Ken Gibb had said. So I think there's an element in about how do you get more monies, and I talked about investment discussions with local authorities and the likes of SFT and SNIB and Hubco and so on. So how do we get more money into the sector in terms of that? So I think there has to be, of course, there has to be an element in social housing, but it has to be an all-tenure approach as well, because one of the key things, for example, is we know in East Lothian and Mid Lothian and other parts of Scotland, there's a lot of house building going on. If you're talking about 25% affordable housing, if you're not building any housing, you know, through the all-tenure approach from developers, then 25% is zero. If we manage to get, you know, if the housing building sector itself picks up, as we hope it will, with interest rates hopefully dropping, then the element of housing the affordable housing would obviously increase in terms of that. So it has to be an all-tenure approach, but there has to be that specific focus. And one of the key things that came out in the Housing Investment Task Force and was made very clear at that particular point was the funding around about that would be a particular focus on social housing in terms of that. It needs an all-tenure approach, but the Housing Investment Task Force was given out and in terms of reference were agreed at that particular point around about it has to be focused on affordable housing and social housing. So again, this is where the work will kind of come out that's be referenced in the Housing Investment Task Force in terms of that. In terms of the voids, I think it's a really important issue. Now, and again, for example, in Edinburgh, they talked about the number of voids they've had. There's a specific piece of work kind of going on, and I reference this in every discussion I have with local authorities. The meetings we've had with the COSLA and the LACHER around about that national approach and how do we drive these down, because there's far too many. There are far too many. What does government need to do, but what do local authorities need to do in terms of that? And it comes back to the housing emergency action plans we talked about and the discussions we're having with them. So how do we help Edinburgh get their voids down? Now, part of the element in Edinburgh isn't a funding issue. It's part of they haven't got enough workforce to deal with that. So how do we work with them in terms of getting delivering that workforce? And it's slightly different in different parts of Scotland. So again, it comes back to how do we look at that. But the voids issue is something we need to make sure we're driving down, because you know, in terms of number temporary accommodation units, this could make a real difference in terms of what's there that's available to local authorities to drive that down. We shouldn't be having there are always going to be an element of voids. There are always going to be that carry forward in terms of that, as you know. But if we've got over 1,500, and I think that was in the discussion, it was mentioned at the round table at Miles and I were at, if they've got 1,500 voids and you're talking a number of people that are in temporary accommodation, that's far too much. It's far too much. Now, I'll give Edinburgh thanks in terms of they're now beginning to drive that down. But there needs to be focus nationally across Scotland. The discussions we have with COSLA and LACHER are focused on what we need to do to deliver that, to drive that down.
And your views on a national acquisition strategy?
I think in terms of the £60 million we talked around about, I think that's made a dramatic difference in terms of that. Again, if we can try and flex the funding within the system, I think that's a key element that we need to look around about continuing acquisitions. When the RPAs come out, the planning assumptions for local authorities in terms of that, they have the flexibility now to look at acquisitions. So there's nothing actually, they have the powers to do that now. So again, speaking to the local, I suppose the local officers in terms of that, they are having these local discussions. Again, we mentioned this to any local authority, they have the power to do that now in terms of acquisitions. So again, we're flexible when it comes to discussions around about that. So they have the ability to do that now in terms of that, as we continue to obviously try and look at more funding opportunities and flex up the funding system and that. But local authorities have the ability to do that now.
The stakeholders also were keen to stress that a focus on social housing shouldn't mean that we neglect pursuing retrofitting and building green homes. A couple of things in that. How can we continue to pursue the goal of zero emissions from homes?
An example I might give you is that I have quite a number of constituents living in conservation areas who are unable to install solar panels, are unable to install anything that would contribute towards zero emissions. And I know other councils also take the same view. Apparently, the legislation does not permit them to allow that sort of development in a conservation area. You're never going to get zero emissions if conservation areas aren't allowed to pursue these. And the other thing is, what progress is made on the Green Heat Finance Task Force?
The Green Heat Finance Task Force, I understand, is due to report, I think it was indicated, and I'll double check this, I think it was around about the end of April, was what I'm aware of. I referenced that earlier on because it comes back to the specific advice that would be for local authorities and housing associations. And you're right, I mean, it's raised in terms of discussions, and I think Stephanie mentioned it before around about, you know, where do you reference repairs, where do you reference in terms of you know, retrofitting, for example, and investment into new stock. We need to get that clarity around about the Green Heat Finance Task Force and what opportunities that are there. And I think the figure, and we discussed it at this committee, was £33 billion in Scotland, but it would create 15,000 to 20,000 jobs. And that has to be underwritten, be institutional investment. You know, I think the figure in the UK is about, it's over £1 trillion. So again, when you're talking around about what that needs to be done, it needs to be done around about that. You know, it's going to take institutional investment. There are various models that I know that are being discussed and debated within the Green Heat Finance Task Force in terms of what does that look like, and specifically what does that look like for local authorities and housing associations. So we need clarity on that. I think hopefully the report that will come out will give a bit of clarity in terms of that. What does it look like for local authorities? That has to be underwritten by the LHE strategies, their heat and energy efficiency strategies. The strategies have been produced for local authorities. They're now moving on to deliverability plans. So I know there's a lot of work, for example, going on in East Lothian, as you know, in terms of what's been developed there. Each local authority is doing that. What does deliverability can you look like? In terms of the conservation areas, there's a permitted rights development review going on at the moment in terms of what does that look like. And what do we need to do, again, in terms of, for example, if you were looking to put on you know, solar panels, it becomes impossible. If you're looking to look at the windows, it becomes impossible. So there's a review going on about the permitted rights development at the moment to see kind of what that looks like to feed into that. Because you're right, that's going to be an element, a big part of some particular areas where there's old, you know, where they're in conservation areas. What does that look like? So there's a review going on in terms of that just now. So the next 6 months in that area, I think, is incredibly important, but we need to do it. There is no doubt we need to do it, but how do we make that work financially, both for individual householders, but for local authorities and housing associations as part of that broader discussion about investment and how they deal with conditions of properties and so on. So, and again, I would, it's up to the committee, but I'm sure when that task force reports, there'll be some kind of discussion and debate I'm sure would need to be held about that. So,
when is that review going to be completed? When will we see a report?
I'm not sure if Joe and Laura can talk. I can come back to you on that one, but I know that's an ongoing review just now, but I can come back to you on that particular point and write to committee on that particular point.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much. Very useful questions and responses. I'm going to bring in Stephanie Callaghan now.
Thanks, Convener. Minister, I appreciate you've touched on this already, just at the start with Ariane. I'd like to ask a little bit more about tenants and residents. And it was really good to hear Joe mention the start of the external phase and that you personally are planning to visit lots of different communities there directly. Because I think we can all agree it's vital tenants and residents' views do inform and influence because people's homes have such a huge impact on their wellbeing and their health. So I'd be interested to hear more about how the Scottish Government will seek to involve local communities, tenants and residents in delivering the ambitions of Housing to 2040, and also how you'll know if outcomes have improved for communities actually on the ground and embed that going forward.
I think one of the most important points is we have a representative from tenants and residents on the Housing to 2040 strategy group. I think that's really important to get their point of view so they feed into that, and again that was recognised as being a really important member of that. I've visited and been at a number of tenants and residents group meetings and conferences where it's kind of discussed, but and again I think it's really important. You know, I mean, I was councillor for 15 years and tried to set up tenants and residents groups. It was really, really important part of kind of what goes on. So I think, you know, the very point that they're a member of the House in the 2040 group, I think is incredibly important, because they can then feed into the wider strategy. That's in terms of engaging, again, engaging with the group. And I try to meet them probably in every 6 months. But if there's a national organisation that kind of represents them in terms of that, I probably try and meet them every 6 months to discuss that. But I have spoken at a number of Thames residents conferences on this particular point, and Q&As, for example, in terms of that. But having their views represented in the strategy group, I think, is incredibly important. But meet them on a regular basis to discuss some of the issues. The retrofitting element of that comes in, and their role in terms of how they then speak to their own groups around about what does that look like, because part of the challenges around about the retrofitting is the communication that we kind of talked about. So what does that kind of look like? So at the moment we're talking about, I suppose it's the development stage. Once we actually start moving on that, we move beyond the LHU strategy and it's starting to look authorities and housing associations. And private residents starting to look around about what does this actually mean for me? That's a really important part where tenants and residents groups kind of come in and can feed into that. And they have to. Because, and again, because it's real change that we need to be developing in terms of, we all know we need to do it. It's a big, big challenge to actually then go and deliver it, but we need to do it. Tenant and resident groups are an incredibly important part of that. So look forward to discussing that with them going forward.
And are you able to say any more about outcomes as far as that's concerned? Would that be part of a similar framework?
In terms of
the outcomes improving for communities and for individuals and for residents as we move forward?
I think one of the key things for that will be the indicators part of it, and what does that kind of look like? Because we can all say anecdotally, is it working or is it not? What does it actually look like? And I think one of the key things, I think that's kind of still being discussed. And I think one of the, again, this kind of comes back to the LHU strategies, because the LHU strategies shouldn't just include what do we need to do in terms of fabric first? What do we need to do in terms of heating systems? Like district heating systems are in that at all. What is the information that needs to go around about that, and what's the support around about that? I think it's really important that we get indicators going on about that particular point. I can come back to you in more detail around about that. A lot of that will come down to what the local authorities are doing in terms of that themselves, how they monitor that, and how that's fed into the Scottish Government in terms of that. But that needs to be part of an early strategy. It's not just around about how much money is it costing, where is it going, what are the heating systems, is it how do we then get out with that information that's required to do that. And I know when we spoke at the Sky on the Cash conference, we talked about part of that was how did they get information. And I know, and again, I talked about Insulate and a small example, how do they get out and speak to the communities that are out there, and how do you indicate that? And there needs to be metrics around about that and how we develop that. But that should be part of the LHU strategies. And you're then moving in, by the end of this year, it's talking about the deliverability stage, not just the strategy, how are you actually going to deliver this in terms of that. It's going to be a challenge. Of course, it's going to be a challenge. But the information that we get out and how we measure that is an incredibly important part of it. I think that's been developed with local authorities at the moment.
Thanks. Okay. Thanks very much. We've got a few more questions to go. I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Convener. We know that housing circumstances vary fairly dramatically across the country, particularly when you look at urban and rural. And I just wonder how successful the Minister feels that Housing to 2040 has been at addressing the differences between urban and rural housing needs and demands, and whether there's going to be any assessment going forward as to essentially how well particular rural needs have been served by Housing to 2040.
I think that's a really important question. I think Housing to 2040 acknowledges that there was a Rural Housing Action Plan that it came out in October. And again, I think there's a review going on. There were short-term indicators that were carried out, medium-term, long-term. So there's a view going on just now and about what the short-term indicators are and how we're looking at that in terms of that. I think as part of the Rural Housing Action Plan, I said I would come back to either committee or Parliament at that stage in terms of saying, look, here's an update one year on in terms of that. So we're very transparent around about that, so happy to come back to committee or to Parliament in terms of that. Later on this year, you know, we've had a year, it'll be a year in October. In terms of that, I indicated how important it was for me in terms of last year going out for the visits, and I'll do that again this year, because again, I think it's very different, even within the rural communities themselves, in terms of that. Talked about the importance of the work that SSCN are doing in terms of that, because again, there's an element, if you're talking about the renewables hubs, for example, and I'll come back to the point you mentioned, but renewables hubs, if we're talking about the requirement for Western Isles, for example. They're talking about roughly 1,000 jobs that would bring. It can't just be round about the main population centres. It has to be spread across the whole communities. It's the same, for example, in Inverness, it's the same in Shetland, it's the same in Orkney, for example. So that needs to be developed as well. In terms of actually the importance of that, I think I'd say to come back and made a statement. We've talked about the rural housing funding. Let's say we talked about the rural housing funding for key workers. There needs to be more with local authorities done on that. I mentioned when I was down and talking to Argyll and Bute in terms of that. There needs to be that strategic overview. We had a round table with some key employers around about that again. So there's work being carried out in terms of that. But the key thing is coming back and making that statement to either yourselves or Parliament, which I'd said right at the start of this, we'd be happy to do that in terms of being held to account and how successful that has been in terms of housing to 2040, but also in terms of what we need to do. And again, you know, we've had these discussions. You know, that it will continue to develop. If we'd seen 3 or 4 years ago around the opportunities around about the renewables, for example, that's not something I think it would be in consideration then. Now it's an incredibly important part of what we need to do going forward. It can bring jobs, it can also bring that housing. So how do we make sure we're connecting the housing and the employability? Because if we don't get that bit right, then it's going to create problems around about homelessness, but it's also going to be an opportunity to talk about legacy housing, which SSEN are really keen to sit down and discuss with us as well. So but happy to come back to committee in October time or go back to Parliament. I think we'd indicated we would do that anyway. So, but it's an incredibly important part of what we need to do, because it is completely different, as you said, in urban and rural communities. And it comes back to part of the issues as well, because we talked about construction inflation. You're probably adding another 15-20% in terms of costs when you go, you know, in terms of delivering homes in rural communities. It becomes even more challenging in terms of that. So again, the discussions we've been having with local authorities in rural communities is how do we deliver, such as rural housing, how do we deliver key workers funding, how do we look at the renewables opportunities in that as well, or can it all ties in terms of that? Okay. And the Housing Investment Task Force, again, coming back to that specific point, was asked not just to look at funding for urban communities, but have a real focus on rural housing as well. So how do we make sure that it's not just looking at urban communities, it's looking at rural opportunities, and how do we fund that and the particular challenges that they face? So again, that will be referenced in the Housing Investment Task Force reports, and it's a key piece of work kind of going forward.
Okay, thanks for that.
Thanks. And of course, in the case of rural communities and island communities, there's requirements around the whole government strategy on repopulation, maintaining population, and also the Islands Act and the work in there. So lots of things to support us, making sure that we've got that nuanced approach. I'm going to bring in Pam Gosol.
Thank you, convener. New statistics from March highlight a significant drop in housing completions and starts in Scotland. Homes for Scotland underscores that most critical challenges are around the underfunding planning system, taking over 62 weeks for a major housing application, and a regulatory environment that hampers rather than promotes new home delivery. What bold action is needed to support housing delivery across the 10 years, all 10 years, Minister?
Kenny touched on these briefly. I think that one is resource, and I think this committee discussed this before in terms of this, about the resource that's required. So there's the resource review that's kind of going on just now, I think is really incredibly important. I think that's, again, working with Homes for Scotland are part of that. I mentioned about the housing round table, the planning round table we had. Homes for Scotland, again, were involved in that and are having discussions with Chief, the heads of planning at the moment. And I think it's been productive so far. There's another round table planned in terms of how we look at that. I think that's one part of resource. Two is how do we... And I think there's an element in terms of the transition, the feedback certainly we've got is transition from NPF4 to NPF, NPF3 to NPF4 in terms of what does that look like, and what's the transition from then. I think that's incredibly important. And then comes back, I think, in terms of the deliverability, it's having that, it's focused on resource. I think that's an incredibly important part. It's how do we get that planning time down in terms of that. And but it does come back, as I say, to the round table we've been having around about the transition. And that's certainly feedback, because Joe Fitzpatrick and I have joint meetings with Homes for Scotland, and this issue is raised. So there's, you know, part of the reason we had the round table was around about that. The resource review obviously feeds into that as well. So obviously need to look at the planning system that works as effectively as possible. So these pieces of work continue to ongoing. And again, happy to come back or you know, maybe through Mr Fitzpatrick and report on progress on these. And again, I think part of it then comes back to, if we're delivering a number of houses, I mean, you come back to the point you said around about the devil who starts, I think it comes back to how do we support the SME sector as well in terms of that, because obviously they're more, I suppose, vulnerable to the situations in terms of, you know, if interest rates go up or whatever, or borrowing costs go up, we've seen that, you know, that can mean, so how do we support the SME sector? So the discussion's going on about how we support the SME sector as well. But the resource review and how we make sure the transition from NPF3 to NPF4 into local development plans. And again, you know, they've done the work on the demand. They're having individual discussions, for example, with local authorities and then about what does a local development plan, what does a Martler process involve in terms of that. So again, that kind of all feeds into that, but it is around about resource. It is around about making sure the system works effectively as possible.
No, thank you, Minister. But, you know, it takes over 6 to 2 weeks for a major application. That's quite a long time. And I know there's a lot of detailed work to be done in an application and planning. However, that's quite a long time. And especially when you speak about SMEs or businesses that are basically just making ends meet and balancing the books. What's your opinion and your on that, on the 6 to 2 weeks?
Yeah, I know I haven't been councillor for 15 years. Sometimes, if they're larger developments, they do take a longer period of time. 6 to 2 weeks is too long, and I think part of the resource review has indicated that in terms of making sure. And there's also a piece of work with Homes for Scotland, for example, in terms of the because it's got to be a partnership, in terms of the actual information that's provided at the start of an application. And because, again, there might be ongoing back and forward discussions saying we need this in terms of that. And I've seen that and applications when I was a councillor at that particular time. You know, it can go back and it might wait a particular period of time before you get information back. It's also talking to, and again, the review as part of that is, you know, where does SEPA come in, where does Scottish Water come in terms of that, and how do they quicken their processes as well. So I know they've been part of the discussions, for example, around about reducing that number of work. Mr Fitzpatrick is probably the best person to speak around about the specific discussions, but I know there's been discussions with SEPA, Scottish Water, the statutory consultees, if you like, in terms of about that, reducing that period of time. But yeah, we need to be reducing that 60. And I know it varies in different parts of Scotland. So again, it's learning from best practices in other parts of Scotland in terms of what it looks like. But we need to bring that down. But as I said, the resource review, the round tables we've been having, another one we've got planned, you know, we'll hopefully begin to show some progress on that particular point.
Thank you, Minister. I've got one more question. Yeah. We know that public finances are stretched and they're very tight at the moment. How can private investment be further encouraged in Scotland's housing sector? Witnesses suggested that investors seek more certainty. What steps can the Scottish Government take to offer that assurance?
I'll come back. The Housing Investment Task Force was pulled together for that specific point, was pulling together banks, the institutional investors, in terms of that, the actual local authorities, housing associations, in terms of that. So that's looking at the barriers that are there to investment and the opportunities that are around that. So I think that's a really important piece of work, and I think the feedback we had from the first meeting was incredibly positive. So actually having all the potential funders involved in terms of that, it is one part. I had met in London in October, met 25 institutional investors talking about that. Got a round table this Thursday with investors, again, talking about that in terms of the housing bill, and where does that kind of fit in terms of that. We're talking about the broader flexing up of the finance system in terms of, so we're talking about how you're getting SNB involved, SFT involved, how we look at HubCo and in terms of that. So again, that's not institutional investment, but it's trying to flex the system we've already got there. I talked around the use of guarantees, for example, that would be really useful in terms of, you know, being able to offer that to investors and so on. So there's lots of discussions kind of going on. The Housing Investment Task Force is the main part, but there's lots of pieces of work going on around about that. But I've met with the Housing Roundtable, institutors now, institutional investors, probably in about half a dozen times, and that will continue to develop, and particularly through the Housing Investment Task Force, which will report on in terms of where they think the barriers are, what the opportunities are in terms of flexing up that whole system. But we need that. You know, we need that. It's not to replace what we've already got in terms of funding. It's to supplement that. Because the demand is there. Pure and simple, demand is there. We need to look at different opportunities about bringing money in. Institutional investment is an incredibly important part of that. And I talked about, for example, not just in terms of housing, but the lease model, for example, down in different parts of London, around about providing temporary accommodation as well. So there's, and for example, about social investment housing, working with homelessness charities, which I know there's about half a dozen in Scotland that are already looking at that model in terms of that, and there are models already in place where that kind of works. It's trying to flex up the system, But institutional investment is vitally important in terms of what we need to do.
Well, I look forward to the feedback from the task group, because if there's something that was said in our round table a couple of weeks ago was about the supply, the fact that we don't have that housing supply, and it's important that we have that investment, and certainty is key.
And I think that's another point. I think it's been really important. I mean, I met with a couple of examples. One, I met with the City Region team in Edinburgh, asked for a meeting, and we talked about there are about 7 or 8 housing developments, strategic housing developments, that need to be brought forward. So we just kind of discussed that in terms of how do we bring that forward. And one of the discussion that kind of came at the end, they said, look, is it an investment prospectus that you need? And yeah. So they're going to be developing that just now, and we'll come back to in terms of that. I think it's an opportunity to sit down with investors to say, how do we deliver on that? And we're then talking around about, I've had a discussion and asked for a meeting with the Cities Alliance. So the Cities Alliance obviously are really important in terms of what they need to do to deliver housing, for example, and redevelopment of city centres. So again, Glasgow is doing something similar to the City Region element in terms of that. But it's also looking at about what investment do we need and for institutional investment in terms of the main cities in Scotland. So again, the Cities Alliance are almost trying to do part of that work as well in terms of that. So what is the demand that we can try and generate, for example, around about the City Region in Edinburgh and Glasgow, but what can we do around about the Cities Alliance and what investment do we do that? Because if you then start and aggregate that figure and speaking to investors, you're talking about a huge substantial amount of money that over a period of time would need institutional investment as well as Scottish grant funding, as well as trying to flex up the system we already have at the moment around about housing. So it's an element of trying to bring all these together. But the demand is there. How do we finance it is the most important part. And this is where we're talking about the flexing and the finance system we've got at the moment and the Housing Investment Task Force to try to look at that in a whole. And again, as I said, the Housing Investment Task Force will be, I think Joe had mentioned around about the first minutes coming out of that pretty shortly. But that was certainly, it was encouraging some of the ideas and whatever we had coming forward at that time. The group itself will bring forward recommendations.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. It's interesting to hear over the course of the morning about the work of the Housing Investment Task Force and, you know, the potential for that. You also mentioned the work of Professor Ken Gibb a number of times. And one of the things that he brought up in the round table that he attended is a concern around the ambition in Housing to 2040 to despeculate the housing market. And I just wonder how you keep that in mind, how the Housing to 2040 strategy group discussed that, how that's kept in mind, because at the kind of foundation or the heart of everything we're talking about is probably that whole speculative aspect that's entered into the market. So how do we move away from that and really get to that place where Scotland's providing homes for people?
I think that's important. Ken is a part of the Housing Investment Task Force. So, again, feeding in his input will be really valuable in terms of that. And again, you know, he talked about data and offered to do some piece of work around about that. So that will be developed as part of the Housing Investment Task Force. And I think the reason that Ken was kind of asked was to give that broad kind of overview, because it's not... If we're talking about flexing up the system and talking about institutional investment, that balance across all tenures is really important. So I think having Ken's influence in that, talking about despeculating the market, I think is one of the key things. Mm-hmm. So I'm not saying it's systemic change, but we have to look at it. It has to be a whole systems approach. We can't just change one part of it or another part of it. It's that whole system. And having Ken as part of that, I think, is really important to get that academic input into that. And I think, as I said, Ken advises all the governments in the UK in terms of that. So, you know, his overview of what's available, for example, in guarantees, the UK government, and I think he mentioned that in his article in the Herald, talked around about other opportunities for the Scottish government to look at guarantees that might help us in terms of that. Wouldn't be any additional costs to the UK government, but it would be really helpful. So his input in terms of that and trying to get that system, whole system approach, is really important. And, you know, Ken, I think, will feed in from the academic point of view in terms of that. And we heard that from the group itself when we talked about innovative finance. The Housing to 2040 group itself, they talked about one of the main priorities right now, short term, is how we flex up the finance system. The Housing Investment Task Force is looking at that, as well as other issues around about that, which talks us not just in developing more housing, but developing, if we're talking about temporary accommodation, how can we look at models around about that as well? So, but Ken, I think, will give us that balance with the expertise that he's got.
Good. Yes, I'm glad you're glad you've got somebody on board who's got that awareness of that despeculation.
So if we don't, I'm sure he'll tell us that we're not doing that.
Good. Well, I just want to say thanks so much for... Oh, actually, Mark, you've got a supplementary. Come on in.
Yep, thanks, Winnett. I think it's right that we look for sources of finance from wherever we can when we're in a housing emergency. I just wanted to maybe reflect a degree of nervousness, I think, that I'm picking up from social landlords when it comes to potentially changing the balance of funding affordable housing, even if it's ever so slightly away from grants to sources of private finance. And I wonder whether the Minister might reflect on how we would make sure that when we are bringing in potentially other sources of funding, that the end result isn't that the burden of the return on investment, which investors will rightly expect, doesn't fall on the tenant.
And I think that's really important, because the discussions we had, for example, we talked around about, we discussed, for example, with housing associations and local authorities, were obviously slightly different. So we talked about discussions with SFT, SNIB, HUBCO, for example. There's that broader housing investment task force, so we've got local authorities represented on that, obviously to input into that. There should be an addition, not in terms of trying to replace or supplement. And the discussions that were ongoing around about institutional investment have probably been going on for around about nine months that I've, you know, mentioned, for example, in October, having discussions with institutional investors. I want to be in the same position as other countries in Europe. I don't have the ability to go out and borrow money to build houses. It's as simple as that. I don't. So I need to look at how we flex up that system in terms of what we've got just now. But very clear, and I've said it, and I'll say it here, it's not to replace the funding, it's to supplement the funding. And I think when we talked about what Housing 2040 strategy group said, they talked about innovative ways of financing. So the group itself, I've seen this as a really important part. The devil is in the detail in terms of it. So there are discussions ongoing, for example, with SNIB and SFT and HUBCO, with local authorities and landlords in terms of what does it actually look like? Where does it give them the comfort? So it's going down into that level of detail. Where do they need that? Now, the use of guarantees might be something in terms of that kind of gives them some reassurance. So it's not, and it can't be in terms of, if we're getting institutional investment, where do rent levels go? It can't be at that level. So there has to be that balance. Again, with the Housing Investment Task Force and the discussions we've been having, local authorities and RSLs are included in that. So they're inputting into that process. They're part of that process in terms of going forward. But yeah, it's not to to replace, it's to supplement of what's there. It's to try and get more money into the system. But they're fully involved in terms of the discussions that are ongoing. So there's not going to be anything that will be decided in terms of, you know, the recommendations coming forward without their input into that. And again, it'll come back to the Housing 2040 group. And again, where they've got a major part of that, they'll obviously be their inclusion into the debate in terms of that as well. So it's not a side. And we talked about the deliverability review and Housing Investment Task Force. They are fully integral in that part of it.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks. And I'm going to bring in Stephanie Callaghan.
Thanks very much, Convener. I will be brief. Minister, just to go back slightly and touch on what Pam was talking about there, about the length of time for planning applications, and as a previous councillor myself as well, I've seen how much interaction there is, how many visits, for example, the discussions with council planning staff, etc., there to get the detail right and make sure they are. So I suppose it was just looking for a little bit of reassurance that work is recognised and that won't be compromised, and also that the kind of the statutory pre-application consultations for your major housing developments with residents and communities, that won't be compromised as well.
And you're right, I mean, there has to be that balance. I mean, the pre-application consultations come in a number of years ago, and I think that's really valued in terms of where it is, and it's really important. I know that can be varied across different parts of the country and with different developers, but it's a really, really important part of it. And it comes back to the point, I think, that the convener made around about place plans. If we're getting developments that are coming forward, developers should be looking at the place plans that are kind of there. And I think that's really important. It can't just be, you know, there's a development thrown in and it's not taking any cognizance to place plans. Because again, people will get suspicious in terms of going on and saying, what's the point of a place plan? And there's a lot of work goes into these place plans in terms of that. And again, this is where it's got to be fixed, into local development plans. And making sure that there's a flow from place plans through to local development plans through to actual developers coming forward that recognise that. And I think that there has been progress in that. I think there will continue to be progress in terms of that. And it does come back to the whole point around about that it's a two-way process between developers and local authorities to make sure that the information that's sent in is what they need at that particular point, because, again, that quickens it up, as well as how do we make sure that SEPA, Scottish Water and other strategy consultees come back in terms of that. So that's that broader kind of discussion. But we do need, and it comes back to the point that Pam mentioned, we do need to reduce that period of time. But we can't at the detriment to local communities.
I suppose that's just really good to hear, because certainly I have seen really positive influences from that community consultation as well, and it really making changes and making an impact and it being much better as a result. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. That certainly is very reassuring to hear from you that developers should be looking at the local place plans. And I think that will help us get to that sense of place. And it'll be interesting to see how that develops in the years to come. So I just want to say thanks so much for a very long but useful, thorough morning session. Our first committee back after a brief recess. And as we agreed at the start of the meeting to take the next three items in private, I now close the public part of the meeting.